Tentative millage and budget for 2016-2017. The tentative millage of $2.35 per $1,000 will be 5.77% more than the rollback rate of 2.2217 mils. The total ad valorem taxes generated from the millage of 2.35 will be $22,879,660.87. Net taxes will be $22,185,993.08. The tentative general budget for 2016-2017 will be $33,540,809.38. The tentative impact fee budget for 2016-2017 will be $519,140. Do we have any public input on the millage rate or the budget submitted for 2016-2017? Seeing none, need a motion to adopt and approve the tentative millage rate of 2.35.
I make a motion to adopt.
I will second.
Any discussion? Roll call vote. Commissioner McCourt?
No.
Commissioner Lyles?
Yes.
Commissioner Casilla?
Yes.
Commissioner Murphy?
Yes.
Commissioner Lohan? Yes. Adopt a tentative general fund budget at $33,540,809.38 for fiscal year 2016-2017. Need a motion for that?
Make a motion.
Sir.
Roll call. Commissioner McCourt?
No.
Commissioner Lyles?
Aye.
Commissioner Casilla?
Yes.
Commissioner Murphy?
Yes.
Commissioner Lohan? Yes. Adopt a tentative impact fee budget of $519,140,000 for fiscal year 2016-2017. Need a motion for that?
I so move.
Second it.
Roll call. Commissioner McCourt?
No.
Commissioner Lyles?
Yes.
Commissioner Casilla?
Yes.
Commissioner Murphy?
Yes.
Commissioner Lohan's a yes. Next item, is there any public comment on the regular agenda items? Seeing none, need one motion for the approval of the August 8, 2016 regular board meeting minutes and the August 24, 2016 budget workshop minutes.
Motion to approve.
I second that.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Approval of August 2016 financials, one motion. Need a motion for August 2016 and current expenditures and ACH payments, the acknowledgement of financial report, and the acknowledgement of wire transfers and transfers between accounts.
I make that motion.
Sorry.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. Next item is the disposition report, which was in your packet. I need a motion to accept that.
So move.
Seconded.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Next item on the agenda, commissioner's business. Anybody got anything?
Mr. Chairman, I'd like to say that after 9 months of an investigation, there was no probable cause to any violations, to any electioneering violations, and everything has been dismissed.
That's very good.
And just on the 9/11 ceremony yesterday, I just want to thank whoever set that up, and it was a well run, and I really appreciated what that was done down at Riverside Park.
Anybody have anything else? Next item, old business. I've got some old business that I'd like to discuss tonight. While we're on the 9/11 subject, it seems to me we've kind of hit a wall on, no pun intended, on doing the mural. I know originally the city was going to do it, and we opted to take that over, which is fine. I think they had a, I think their time schedule was to have it done for this 9/11, which obviously is not possible. I think that we as a board need to give some direction to staff to move ahead with this and figure out what we're going to do and how we're going to do it.
Chairman, if you may,
yes.
I may.
We had already started moving forward with it. We have $10,000 in the budget this year for that, so that's why we were dragging our feet, because we didn't have anything in the previous budget to pay for that without taking out a reserve. So our plan was, we knew we wouldn't make it for this year's September 11th proceedings, so our goal was to have the money in the budget for next year and follow through with it and have it ready for the next fiscal year.
Explain to me when you're going to follow through, what you're going to do, because I know there's some disagreement on the actual mural itself that we were shown, and I don't know. Explain to me what you're going to.
First thing we were going to do is contact the actual artist that was presented to the board, I believe, back in June. We are going to contact him and see if he was still A, available to do it, and B, also to do it in a way that we would like it done, as in whatever material we decided to put on the wall itself, whether we're going to paint the bricks or put up a faux wall or whatever. Then the other thing that we were going to contact him on is, I know the board had spoken to the chief and myself about how elaborate the one he demonstrated here with the Bugs Bunny and the space and John Wayne and so on. We were going to speak to him and see if we could tone it down and just make it strictly about fire department and September 11th and the American flag. So those two, pardon me, those two are the options we were looking at to go forward with the artist. If he does not want to follow through with that, then we'd have to go out and find another artist.
I don't think anybody was trying to take away from his creative ability in any way, shape, or form. It's not it's definitely not anything. I know the Art League spoke very highly of him, and he came highly recommended, and I think he's very impressive. I think we need to make that perfectly, abundantly clear that it's not that we're pulling apart his painting. It's just, if we're going to do the theme of a 9/11 memorial, it's going to be a tribute for a long time to come. And with moving the stone from Lyle's Hotel over there and making a little park like we talked about, it just seems to me, and I don't know how the rest, I think everybody else felt that way when we talked about this in the past, that the theme should be more along the lines of the first responders and fire, seeing how it's going to be painted on the side of a firehouse. I think that from where I sit, we need to try to convey that without in any way, shape, or form offending the artist.
Yeah, that was our plan. We were going to contact the city and see if we could get into, have them be a liaison or a go-between to set up the meeting with him, then we would bring him in and speak to him of that.
Okay, so as long as we're moving forward, yeah, with that, because with the rotary, you know, the traffic circle finished now and the project moving along, it would be nice to get back up to speed on that and figure out what we are going to do and get it done.
Mm-hmm. I think the first step was, we took the first step tonight by approving the tentative budget and moving forward, so now we have somewhat of the money ready to go,
right,
and then we're going to go from there.
Chairman Lohan?
Yes, sir.
I would agree most of your comments and only add that I think we should have something on there that relates to our paramedics and you know, giving the image that this is basically what we do. This is what most of our business is, paramedic, and not strictly fire. Okay. And I think that would really help our image.
I think before any image or before any mural is painted, we would definitely get board approval of to what that image is. But, yeah, we'll make sure that we have something in there with the fire, right, and EMS side of it.
And honestly, if the artist wants to come back and talk to us again at a board meeting when we're all here, I would strongly recommend that, because like I said, the last thing in the world we want to do is offend the Art League or offend the artist, because I mean, I have the utmost respect for what the guy does, and I can't draw a straight line with a pencil and a ruler, I think that we're not, again, not trying to take away or second guess his creativity. It's just that the nature of the mural and where it's going to be and what it's going to represent, it may have been a little bit of an overkill, and you know, maybe we can talk to him and see if he's not going to be offended by that.
Okay. Yeah, we'll definitely move forward. Probably in your emails next week, he does have a YouTube video on how he goes about and paints this. He starts out with an American flag, then it goes into the towers. So we'll try and get that video and send it to you guys, so you guys will have it. And what we're going to do is ask him to stop it at a certain point that would be respectful to him and to us.
Well, I guess the next step then is to meet with him.
Yeah.
Or talk to him and maybe get the Art League involved too, so that, like I said, we're not looking to make enemies here. We just want this to be a, you know, it's going to be there for a long time, and we got to do it right.
Okay, sounds good.
Chairman Lohan?
Yes, sir.
I don't think we have to be. I've had a little experience in dealing with artists and public art, selecting public art. Not that I'm an art expert by any stretch. But I find that depending on how you work with the artist, that they find that helpful if they can get some idea from you what you want to see on it. You know,
yeah, well, I would hope that would be true. But yeah. Sometimes, you know, I mean, I know
I think we want to be very, very specific about it. Yeah, mm-hmm. We'd like to see this, and they'll come up with it. You
know? Yes.
Okay. Anybody else have anything? Commissioner's business? Or, I mean, old business, sorry. New business. Need a motion to do the budget transfer number 5?
I'll make that motion.
I'll second it.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Next one is the purchase of Station 27 apparatus. I guess.
Yes, Chief, that'd
you're gonna,
be me.
You're gonna talk
well,
to us
we've
about.
Looked at a couple different trucks, 3 or 4 different trucks. We've actually taken 2 trucks down to the location to pseudo get the approval of the general manager of the facility. This truck right here seems to be the best suited for that area. It is it's an F550 four-door, can carry 3 people. It's got a 1500 a minute gallon pump, so it for pumping capabilities, it has enough ump for what we want to do down on the beach. It can still supply a fire pump down there. It has limited water, it only has 400 gallons of water. Has 30 gallons of foam, so we can still put out, you know, a car fire or something like that, and it's enough water to get the crew started before a full-size engine gets down there roughly 4 to 6 minutes later coming from our station 2. For the price, we feel it is the best thing out there. It's got a stainless steel body, which has got a lifetime guarantee on it. If you looked at the pictures there, you've seen it. It does have LED lighting, so it does have scene lighting. As I said, it can carry up to 4 people. We will have a limited amount of tools on that truck. As in, when I mean tools, I mean we're going to have a full complement of our ALS tools or equipment on there. It will be a licensed ALS vehicle. But when I say other tools, it's not going to have a 24-foot ladder. It's going to have, a 12-foot ladder with an 8-foot ceiling ladder in there. But it will do down there what we need it to do, I think it serves the purpose. The general manager down there, her name is Jennifer. She was very pleased with it. We took a larger truck down there, and she was not very happy with it. So I think this fulfills everything we need down that way.
Sure.
Greg, is that chassis interchangeable?
The box itself is, and the chassis is. Basically, when they built this, what they've done is they've taken a 15 GPM. Pump and then built a shell around it. So we've got 2 550s right now that are 2008, and we've had limited to no problems with them whatsoever, just normal maintenance. So this type of apparatus is, I think, is a well-maintained truck or is a well-manufactured truck. Our initial caution was about the weight capacity of it, but we've been reassured that it's fine. We can carry everything we need to carry on it. And it will have a combination tool, a combination extrication tool, like all the other trucks do. So if we do get a pin in or an extrication, we can at least start it before the other trucks get there.
Need a motion?
I'll make a motion to purchase the new vehicle.
I'll second that.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye.
Just one quick question. You mentioned it has a lifetime guarantee.
That's on the actual not the chassis, but the rescue box.
My question is lifetime of what?
Lifetime, I guess, of the company itself. It is a stainless steel body, so that is good. And that was one of the other reasons why we selected this truck.
You're talking about the box now.
The box, the rescue box on the back where all the equipment
so
goes.
So it can be put on another truck.
Yes,
but our normal lifespan for the average truck is 15 years?
15 years.
So basically it has to last 15 years because normally it's outlived its usefulness after 15 years anyway.
Correct.
Next item is...
Mr. Chairman, point of order. When you took that last vote, did you get a full count of how everyone voted?
I thought you voted to buy the truck, yes?
Yes.
Yeah, I thought he did.
Thank you.
I did, yeah. Next one is proposals for the lawn maintenance service contract. Do you need us to do anything with that?
Just, I don't even think we need an approval, just to let you know that we did get two lawn maintenance contracts in. We are going to go with the lowest bidder, which is Four Seasons Lawn Care and Landscaping. They came in at $46,800, whereas Personal Touch Landscaping and Lawn Services came in at $55,200.
That's crazy.
Okay, it is what it is, but you don't need a motion for that.
No, just, it's in the budget, it's part of the budget process, we just want to let you know that we are going to sign the contract with Four Seasons Lawn Care for the next year.
Next item we need to approve is Resolution 16-09-03, amending the firefighters' retirement system.
What that is, sir, is 90% of it is all internal revenue code changes. So if you refer to your packet, number two and number five are two things that the actual pension board wanted changed internally. One of them was to initiate a vice chairman's position in case the chairman is out. Right now it's kind of a hodgepodge of who's going to run the meeting. So that's the first thing that is changed that they would like to have, is a vice chairman of the board. And the other thing is, if someone happens to pass away before they retire, like let's use Paul Phillips as an example, this provision gives the beneficiary the option either to take the 10 years certain or a lifetime benefit, which is actuarially sound. They're not going to get any more. The actuary will look at how much that 10 year certain is and then divide it out for the lifetime. So it gives them that option.
My understanding is this adds no cost.
No, none of these provisions add any cost. Like I said, 95% of them, 90 to 95% of them are nothing but IRS and Florida statute changes. The other two are just internal requests from the actual pension board themselves.
I'll make the motion to approve this.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye. And final item here is the approval of collective bargaining agreement between Bonita Springs Fire Control and Rescue District and Local 3444.
I have been notified that the Firefighters Union has approved it 51 to 10, I believe, was the final vote on that contract. But it has been approved by the union.
Need a motion to accept?
Make a motion to accept.
I'll second that.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Unanimously passed. Okay, next item, chief reports.
Might as well, I'm on a roll, huh?
Yeah.
I just have a few things tonight. Basically, what I wanted to do is bring the board and the public up to date on where we're at on the two stations that we are in the process of building right now. First thing I'll bring up is Station 27. First thing is, you guys just approved the truck to be purchased for, so thank you very much for that. So that's step one. The next step is the renovation of the structure itself. We, at your last month's board meeting, you signed you gave permission for the chief to go ahead and start negotiating with Avonis, Anovis, construction to start the actual build out of this of the structure. Right now, we're still waiting on a contract from them and from what I gathered from the fire marshal today, a set of plans or a set of drawings so we can submit for permitting. So we haven't gotten as far as permitting yet. As soon as permitting is done, he has advised us it's about an 8-week build out time. From what Fire Marshal Fernandez says, it should be any day now when we get this contract back. When we get this contract back, we'll send it off to our attorneys and make sure there's nothing in there that's advantageous to ourselves. We'll sign it and move forward and get the permitting. From what we've been told from the city, it's about a 5 to 7 day turnaround on the permits. The next thing with Station 27 is the boat lift. We ran into a little snag with the survey, the land and water survey, where the lift is going to go. We've been in contact with Nelson Marine, who is going to do the work. They have gotten a new survey company to go out and do it. We have since cut the check. I believe it was in your board packet tonight to cut the check to do that. As soon as that survey gets done, then we can go for permitting. And as soon as the permit comes in, they said 2 to 3 weeks build time for the dock itself and the lift. The fourth thing about Station 27 is that engineering is done for all the site work. which means we're going to have to do some changing around in the parking lot as it currently is now. If you go there now, there's four parking spots that face east to west. Those will go away, and there's a little planter out front. That will go away. That whole thing will spin a little bit, and we'll be coming out of the station north and south. And those parking spots will go away. So we need to repave that area. Part of the site work is that we have to extend the sidewalk from the edge of the property on the south side to the edge of the property on the north side. So that's all in the site work that we're doing. The only other thing that we have to worry about is we have to go for a variance because of any structure we're going to put up for the either whatever we decide we're going to put over the truck as a shade. We have to get a variance because that building was built on a zero lot line, so we have to go for a variance to get
even to do the like
yes.
the cheeky style.
Yep.
I thought I was under the impression
we don't need a permit to do it. We don't need if we do Indian cheeky hut. We don't need a permit to build it. We just need a variance because it is too close to the lot line. So, sir,
where physically are we going to park the truck?
If you know the actual structure, we'll say the structure is this way. Our unit is this one, the very end two units.
Yeah.
We'll park the truck on the far west side of the unit itself.
Between the road and the end of the building.
Where those
Between
parking spots are.
Between the road and the end of the building. Okay,
yep.
All right. So
right
be,
on the very western end of the
parallel
to building.
The road. Then.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes,
okay.
sir.
All right.
And then we'll come out and make our left or our right out of there. and we're currently asking the current builder that's going to do the renovations if he would like to bid on the site work. If not, we have a couple other people that we have in mind to go out to bid for that, for the site work and the cheeky hut itself, or whatever we decide to do for a shade structure. Lastly, for that station, we are basically in the midst of our hiring process for the six people that we're going to hire for that building. We have a written test tomorrow. We have 97 applicants that have applied. Test is tomorrow. We're doing it to save money. We're doing it in two sessions, one at 9 and one at 1 o'clock, just because of two reasons. One, saves us a little bit of money, and the second is we didn't think we could fit all 97 in here at once with the tables. We didn't want them crammed in there, so we don't want anybody crying foul if sitting on top of each other. So we're starting that tomorrow. After that, we'll grade the test in-house. With Scantron, and on Saturday the 17th, we'll be running them through our own physical agility course. From that, they will either pass or fail and be given a score. Then on the 27th of this month, which is a Tuesday, we'll be doing oral interviews. Right now, we're thinking, since we're hiring six, we're thinking about at least interviewing 12 of them, just in case. And at that point, the chief will make his final decision on which six he will hire. Then they will start sometime probably in October, November, depending on where we are on the build out of the station, when we will start them on a 1 month orientation. So any questions on station 27, where we're at on it?
Assistant Chief, those wouldn't actually be the guys that will be at that station.
No.
They will be all over.
They'll
the place
be all
and
over.
Other people will be moved there.
Most likely the personnel at station 2 right now, since they are currently boat operators, they will be at that station because at that station, as you know, we're going to have the boat, so it's going to have a limited number of personnel, three people total, so it's going to have a lieutenant, a paramedic, and a boat operator. So I would suspect that none of those people we hire right away would be eligible to be down at that station.
Thank you.
Anything else?
And where are we on where we stand now on station
26?
26.
That was my next one. I was just making sure we didn't have any more questions.
I didn't know if you were,
make sure we didn't have any more questions on 27.
No, where are we in the process of 26?
For 26, where we are at 26, the actual ladder truck that we're buying, and I just want to put it out there right now, the ladder truck that we're buying, 107 Pierce, it is being bought because of that station, but not necessarily, it may not be at that station. We're going to look at different deployment models. It may actually be at this station, but the reason why we're buying it is that station is coming online, and we may rotate a truck to put out there. But that truck is coming along. Specs should be ready for review in mid-October, which means myself, probably Bruce Sheffield, our EVT, and Keith Van Gelder, our other EVT, will probably be going to Appleton, Wisconsin, just to go over the specs to make sure lights are where they're supposed to be on the drawings themselves.
Right.
Then probably 6 to 8 weeks after that, we'll go up for the pre-paint and then the final, and obviously at that point a commissioner or two will be invited on each one of those. We do want a common denominator, myself or Bruce going, all three of them, so just so you guys know. But that's coming down the road, hopefully not in February like the last time.
It was cold.
excuse me. Next, the plans for 26, talked to Gore McKay in the last week. Plans for 26, for Station 26, should be ready to go out for permitting in October and November. So what that means, they'll be ready to be submitted to permitting. From what I understand from the fire marshal, we'll submit them for the permits, have the permits in hand, and at that point, we will go out for bid for RFP and bid for the construction company at that point. We figure that will be going on right around December, November, December, January, in that time frame to submit it, give them 30 days. And again, I'm just shooting from the cuff. We'll have the lawyers draw it up, but 30 days to submit it, sealed bid, open it, and go from there and select it based on probably a board member, the staff, and Gore McGahey going over these bids. At that point, we'll do a groundbreaking sometime in January through March. And the reason why I give such a big, wide time frame is that, as we discussed in this year's budget during the workshops, it's when are we going to move in there and man that station. If we want to do that more in line in the November time frame so we can hire in October, which would help the budget out.
Move it into next year's budget.
That's why we'll move it into the next budget year. So that's what it will be. We've talked to Gore McGahey, and they said, well, figure out roughly when you want to be moved in, and then we'll go back from there as into when our groundbreaking is going to be. And I believe that is it on those two items, and that's all I have tonight, was just
Thank
to
you.
Bring up that update.
Deputy
oh,
Chief.
I'm sorry, one last thing. I do apologize.
Head
just wanted to remind you.
Just like Joe.
Just wanted to remind you of the final budget hearing, which is on September 26th at 5:01 in these quarters, in these chambers.
Yes, sir. Everybody's got that already? Should have.
Just wanted to throw it out there as a reminder.
Thank you. Deputy Chief Scott.
I do have something tonight. So we decided, Assistant Chief DeWitt and I, to go over some recent calls that we've had. It's about carbon monoxide, odor investigations. We have seemed to have quite a few of those, one today, one last month that had an unfortunate end to it. And they seem like they've been more of those recently than we've had in the past. And usually this time of year, we're concerned about carbon monoxide during hurricane season from generators. And we always think of carbon monoxide from fires. Of course, it's one of the most dangerous gases produced. But what we've been seeing lately is a little different. So part of this is for the public, for an educational process as well as to inform the board. The most recent today, I think the crew here was on the call, and I don't know that the source of that was ever confirmed. They had a carbon monoxide detector that went off in the residence. And I think the best we could figure it was from a golf cart charging in the garage. Now, the reason we say that, we had posted this on the website about charging golf carts, and it produces hydrogen gas, not carbon monoxide, but it sets the detector off. Now, hydrogen is very flammable, but unless it's in a very confined space at high concentrations, it's not dangerous to a human being, but it's very flammable. So it still warrants calling the fire department if your detector goes off, because people may not know the source. So I'm not discouraging that, but just so they know that those two things are not exactly the same. Now, the other calls that we had in August was from carbon monoxide, and it was actually caused by a person that drove their car into the garage, didn't shut it off, left it running, went upstairs and went to sleep. And they woke up in the middle of the night, that the wife did, didn't remember anything from the time they got home almost until she woke up in the middle of the night. Her husband had passed, and our crew showed up with the sheriff's department, immediately noticed the odor, because there's other products. Carbon monoxide is odorless and colorless, but the smoke and everything else. So they backed out, got their packs on, got her out of the house. I took her to the hospital. And it's kind of coincidental. I think 2 months ago in May or June, 3 months ago, we had the same exact type call. Someone that had driven their car into the garage, left it running, And that call actually had a more fortunate outcome. No one had passed. Same thing, I think the wife heard her husband fall in the middle of the night, got up. They were barely conscious, just had enough energy to get to the phone and call 911. Very similar outcome, other than, of course, they both survived. So that was a couple of the things that I wanted to go over. We were proactive this year from our public information coordinator, Natalie Hughes, and I have a little, if you hadn't seen it, we did a piece on Fox News in June. We usually do that right before hurricane season. So if you hadn't seen it, just for the public as well, I was going to play it so you could take a look at it. It's only a minute and 40 seconds or so. No.
Fire department, and they had some helpful tips to share. Here's what I learned.
The aftermath of a hurricane or tropical storm in Southwest Florida can be long periods without power. While generators can be useful to get the essentials up and running, it's important to know how to operate one safely.
That is absolutely the most dangerous part of the generators is the gas that they get, carbon monoxide they give off.
Nicknamed the silent killer, carbon monoxide is a colorless, odorless, and tasteless gas that can be deadly within minutes. Deputy Chief Richard Scott with Bonita Springs Fire Rescue says that's why it's important to be aware of your surroundings if you ever decide to use a generator.
One of the problems that people do is they put these generators in their homes, they put them in their garages, and or even too close to your house, where you have an open window or door, and if the wind direction's right, it can accumulate in your house. And by the time that you realize that you are having effects of carbon monoxide, it may be too late.
It's also important to know the symptoms of carbon monoxide poisoning.
You're becoming lethargic, you have a sudden headache, you're not feeling quite well, you might have chest pains. You do need to exit the home immediately, get to a well-ventilated open air area, and dial 911.
To protect yourself from the dangers of carbon monoxide, you want to keep the generator at least 20 to 25 feet away from your home and never operate one inside your home or garage. A carbon monoxide detector, which can be purchased at any department store, can also be a life-saving item to have.
Especially when you're using things like a generator that can emit that poison, that gas, it's very important that your home is detecting this.
Bonita Springs Fire Rescue also urges that when using a generator, be sure to use heavy-duty outdoor extension cords to prevent electrical hazard.
So one of the reasons that I showed that is, although that piece was mainly... Sorry. That wasn't intended for the... So where was I? Oh, the generator. So that was the point of the story, but the carbon monoxide detectors turned out that has a lot of other uses. I mean, we just never have had that experience before where people have left their cars in. I think as cars get more quiet, you don't hear the engine running as much. Obviously, it's a danger as well, and in the last few months, it's been more than the generator since we haven't had any storms. Now, both of the people I mentioned that had the carbon monoxide from the cars, neither one of them were alerted by the carbon monoxide detectors. We've had several of these golf cart charging in the garage. They have had carbon monoxide, like I mentioned earlier, and they have gone off because of the hydrogen gas produced. So I guess the big message here is the carbon monoxide detectors is a very, very valuable thing to have in your home for many reasons. It's not just if you think you don't need one because you don't have a generator and you don't run it in your garage or outside the house, it may be you could have your neighbor have the car. The last one was a townhouse.
Right.
After the guys got the people out of the main building, they had to go clear the rest of the building. And two of them, they had a forcible entry because then one answered the door. And the levels were so high within the entire building that it could have been fatal to anybody in it. Luckily, there was no one else in. They had to break a window in one and force a door in the other and get inside with the police and full air packs and make sure those people were clear. So, again, that's kind of the message we're sending. Okay.
I assume that the automobile industry is aware of this problem.
They know they give off carbon monoxide. Now, as far as what they're doing, I know where you're going with this. If they had to do some kind of detection system inside or around the car, it could shut off. But
I've had a couple of people, and funny you should mention this, because just in the last month, that have come over for dinner and left their car running in the driveway. Now, it's not a problem there.
Right.
I can see where people, cars are running so quiet that...
I know. You get distracted, you get out of the car, you mean to go back down and check
something.
A lot
of cars have remote start, and if you have that, if you have it in your pocket and you push it a couple of times, you can actually start your car without even realizing that you started it.
Yeah, and still be in your home. Yeah, it's something we haven't really paid that much attention to, only because we're reactive. We try to be, you know, like I said, the film we showed about the generators, but usually after these calls happen, then we, of course, get more involved and try to find a way to prevent these from happening again. One thing that we have worked on the last couple weeks is, I don't know if you know this, but there really is no treatment for carbon monoxide poisoning. It's odorless, colorless, it connects your body, displaces the oxygen in your body, and your body carries it throughout your body, and that's what makes it so dangerous. But there's no treatment other than a high-pressure hyperbaric chamber once you get to the hospital. So Assistant Chief DeWitt and I did some research, and we found Virginia Commonwealth University, and we contacted them. This is a point of interest, and I hope this comes to be in a few years. They have a product that actually treats hydrogen cyanide gas, which we have a treatment for that, and carbon monoxide. So supposedly they have developed this product. They're in the process of getting it manufactured by a company, and we've talked to them for quite a while, a week ago or so, and volunteered to be hopefully one of the first departments to have that available. So they are gonna contact us when they get that approved. They already have a patent on it, and as soon as they get it produced, it's ready to go out, and it's been approved. So that's
on another note.
Kind of exciting.
Well,
yes,
we
sir.
We have the program for the smoke alarms.
Mm-hmm.
What would be the possibilities of including carbon monoxide detectors along those lines? How would you distribute those? I mean, would it be something we should look at?
Yeah, we could look at it. They're quite expensive compared to the normal smoke detectors.
Right.
That's one obstacle, I would guess. Mm-hmm. And the way we do that now, our Natalie in our public education, she usually gives out the smoke detectors at, I don't really, anyone that comes in.
They're
and
not
asks
required
for
in new construction, correct? When you build,
as
a
far
new,
as I know, they are.
They're not,
not
required, which
no.
It's kind of.
I know.
I mean, that should be an avenue we should be looking at too. That and probably Tim would have a better feel for that as the fire marshal, but
yeah,
you know, you're required to have smoke detectors. I can't imagine it would add that much cost, especially in new construction, to be required to have the carbon monoxide detectors. And maybe there's a channel we can pursue. At least that would be something that Tim could look into to see if maybe even at a local ordinance level we could make
yeah.
carbon monoxide. I mean, we're having the calls, we're having the issues, and you know, unfortunately, people are dying from this, and
yeah.
I think it's probably important enough that we try to come up with something and get out ahead of it a little bit.
And, you know, with the recent code change with the 10-year battery now in the smoke detectors, those are a bit more expensive. So they're really approaching the price of the carbon monoxide detectors anyway.
But we could partner with
yeah.
Home Depot or Sunshine or somebody, I'm sure, and make them a little bit more affordable.
Yeah, because, of course, in each one of these instances I mentioned, if they had a detector, it most likely would have saved one person's life.
Sure.
And there almost three others were lost as well. So,
and if nothing else, like, you know, not to be redundant, but if nothing else on new construction, maybe we should make it a requirement in our building code that you have to, when you build new, you have to put them in with a smoke detector.
Yeah.
You're talking $50 or $60 or whatever they are. You know, it's not going to change the price of a house.
Mm-hmm. We'll look into it for sure. Yes, Bob Marshall. All right, thank you.
Just one
yes,
second.
Sir.
There's an app on each of our iPhones that is a heart.
Mm-hmm.
And when you press that heart, even if your phone is locked, hit emergency, and you can get to that heart.
Yes.
And it shows all of the information of your medical condition.
Mm-hmm.
Are our guys all trained on knowing to look for that iPhone when they arrive on a scene?
Yes. We actually did another piece on that on the news 2 months ago?
2 months ago.
With Fox as well. To go over that. And yes, we have trained our people to look for those.
Thank you.
So I was surprised how many of us, in fact, when it came to my attention a couple months before that, and then they came to do a news piece on it, but I wasn't aware of it either. And it's only on the iPhone, if I am correct. Isn't that right?
I'd rather not answer, sir.
So, yes. Yes,
that is correct.
They've been trained. Any other questions?
That's it. You have anything else?
No.
Good job.
No.
Thanks.
Thank you.
Mr. Chairman.
Yes, sir.
Can I inquire about our Deputy Chief, Cesar Sanchez's condition?
He's getting better every day. For those of you who didn't know, he had a brief illness, or he still got the illness itself. He's on some medication. He's coming in on a limited basis. He was in today for 2 or 3 hours, and he had some more follow-up tests he had to attend to on Friday. He was here most of the day on Friday, probably 7 of the 8 hours that he was required. So he's getting stronger every day, and day by day. Yesterday, he, for the September 11th memorial, he came to the 1 in the morning at the church, and then started feeling worse as the day went on, so he was unable to attend the one last night. But he is doing better.
Would you give him our well wishes, please?
Yes, I will.
Well, that goes without saying. We're all pulling for him. Any public comment this evening? I have no cards.
Yes, Alex Grant, 11851 East Terry Street. Sorry I was running late, job. But anyway, wanted to find out, this is to the board question, our total liabilities, as I understand, from the 2015 audit, went from $21,153,242 in 2014 to $27,209,584. I was wondering if anybody on the board would be able to address that question. Why that significant increase?
We will have somebody respond to you.
Huh?
We will have somebody respond to you.
Thank you. Also, I think I mentioned to you briefly about Harrisonburg, Virginia, since you mentioned Commonwealth of Virginia. And I did some checking, and I found out that of course, they have a few less calls than we do. They had 4,932 calls, but population was the same, and they had, I think, 81 paid firefighters and 10 volunteers. Pretty similar to Bonita Springs. They have two universities there. They're on the Interstate Highway 81, et cetera. The thing is that I wanted to mention that their total budget for suppression, prevention, training, and administration was $7,617,330 compared to ours. I know that was probably a city budget compared to, this is not a city budget, but still, that's a sizable difference.
It sounds very much like apples to oranges, a comparison, because special districts cover everything and city budgets do not. They don't pay for equipment, they don't pay for buildings. So to compare that would probably, when you filled in all the blanks, it probably would be a lot closer.
Okay.
Thank you. Any further public comment? Motion to adjourn?
So moved.
Thanks for coming.